If you just graduated and are looking for your first job, or you're a victim of this harsh economy, or you're simply looking for a better opportunity, you will want to stay tuned for the next 30 minutes. Our guest today will give you the inside scoop of what the employer is looking for, so that even in today's tough job market, you can land your dream job. Welcome to The Better Part, a program that encompasses a diverse spectrum of topics important to our community, which we hope will both inform and entertain you. We invite you to sit back and enjoy the program. Landing a new job these days is getting tougher and tougher. We have with us Siddharth Agarwal in the studio. He is here to talk about job searching skills, starting with self-assessment, to networking, to writing a resume, preparing for an interview, and finally accepting that coveted job. Hello, Siddharth, and welcome to The Better Part.
Hi, Renu. Pleasure to be here.
Siddharth, tell us a little about yourself and what gives you the ability to give advice to people who are seeking jobs.
Sure. Renu, I run worldwide sales for a company called Zend, which is the PHP company. PHP is a programming language that is used in a third of all the worldwide web applications out there. This includes sites like Yahoo, Facebook, Zynga, et cetera, but also a lot of commercial sites. In my role, I've been responsible for hiring quite a few people over the past 15 years or so. And if you read the book Good to Great by Jim Collins, you'll realize one of the key things to a leader's success is being able to hire the right people so that they have the time to focus on a number of things while their organization is delivering on the goals for the organization.
Well, in this down economy, unemployment rate being so high, people are really desperate. They keep sending out resumes, but they don't hear back. So tell us how someone should start the process of looking for a job and what steps are most effective in landing a job.
Looking for a job is just like sales. It's a law of large numbers. So there are a few sort of key steps in looking for a job. One is assessing sort of what your skill sets are. So that's self-assessment. Then it's about networking, making sure that you connect with people. Then about building a strong resume. And then being able to interview well when you go to the interviews, and then working with job offers.
Okay, I guess you have to have a strategy to look for a job. Okay, let's start with self-assessment.
Well, you know, just as people are trying to figure out what is it that you're capable of, so you have to start thinking about, you know, what are your work-related skills? What are you interested in? And then learn from the experiences that you've had, both academic experiences and professional experiences. And then more importantly, thinking about what kind of a position am I looking for? Where do I want to live? What kind of a lifestyle do I want in terms of how much do I want to work? Given the number of people that are out of a job, people are trying to find candidates that align very closely to what they're looking for because there's so many applicants for the job. So once you've answered these questions, it becomes much easier for you to see if a potential job aligns with your personal goals and how a potential employer might value you with regards to being a close match.
Well, while on the subject of self-assessment, people, especially those who've been without a job, they start having these career-limiting beliefs that I'm not qualified for this job, or I don't have the right skills, or there just aren't any jobs out there. So what would you say to people, you know, to think more positively, you know, not just give up like that?
Sure, absolutely. Giving up is not an option. You do want to get a job. And as I've said, it's a law of large numbers. You have to try and try again until you get the opportunity that you're really looking for. If you think about golfing, you know, what is the probability of a short putt going in the hole? You know, if you don't putt it long enough, it is never going to go in the hole. So you have to putt past the hole.
Right.
So you have to try. So you have to keep trying with the confidence in your strengths and capabilities. And if you really want to change careers or go to a different field, then you have to think about education and how that might prepare you for getting that job that you're looking for.
Reinvent yourself, I guess. Yeah, great advice. where data suggests that most jobs get filled through networking. Mm-hmm. What is networking?
Sure. Networking is probably one of the most important things in this whole job search process. You know, networking is getting that out there and meeting people, be it in a one-on-one situation or in a group setting. It is a chance to get to know the other people and let them know something about you. In the process, you're actually obtaining information. You're asking them a few basic questions like, what do you do? What does your company do, etc. And you're learning what are the opportunities that are out there. You're building personal contacts that will eventually help you find those potential employers. It's just like trying to find a handyman or a painter, right? What do you do when you're looking for someone to fix something in your house? You reach out to your friends because you trust your friends and you know that if they have found someone that can do a job for them, then the probability of them doing the job in the right way for you is pretty high. Otherwise, your friend would not be recommending someone. In that same way, once you've built your network mm-hmm. and you reach out to them or they see a potential opportunity that might fit you, they might recommend you or they might tell you about opportunities that you had not thought of or you were not aware of. So it's just effectively creating a larger group of people that are looking for you for a job, right, to help you get a job.
And, someone for whom it doesn't come naturally, some mm-hmm. people are a little hesitant in going up to anyone and, you know, asking for help. Mm-hmm. How would you suggest that they go about networking?
Mm-hmm. Well, I can completely understand the discomfort that might come from approaching someone, a stranger, and starting to talk to them. I mean, what's the worst that can happen, right? They can just say, I'm busy and walk away, or they might say no to something that you've asked for, mm-hmm. but you've not lost out on anything, right? You just started a conversation, and the plus side of it is you might actually have a great relationship that you build over time. But there are a few things that you can do, if you're not comfortable talking to strangers, you have to try and step outside of that comfort zone. There are a couple online sources that you can use also for networking. So for example, there's LinkedIn. LinkedIn is a professional group. If you go to linkedin.com, everyone who is professional, they put themselves on there, they describe their background, the jobs that they've had, they define who they're connected to, who they know. So as you're looking for a job, you could go to LinkedIn, one, create a profile for yourself, use some keywords that recruiters might be looking for in your area within your LinkedIn profile, and then two, start connecting with your network, right?
So is that only for professionals, this website, or anybody can join it like a Facebook?
Well, anyone can join it, Renu, absolutely. It is for anyone, but the flavor of the website is completely professional. So what the topics of discussion or the kinds of people or the kind of description that they provide themselves is not about what I like, what I have fun doing. It's more about, here are my capabilities. Here's what I've done in the past. Mm-hmm. It's like a resume out there. And then here are the people that I know. So now you could go to LinkedIn once you've built up your network in LinkedIn and go and ask that network if there's a particular company that you're looking for, who would I know in one of those companies or who do my friends know in that company? So it becomes really easy. So that's LinkedIn. Another option is, blogging and tweeting. So blogging is just writing about things that you're interested in. Mm-hmm. You've had life experiences. There are things that you know that other people care to hear about. Blogging is just like writing a diary. Mm-hmm. So you could go to blogspot.com, and I myself have a blog that I sometimes write on in terms of, areas that I'm interested in, and it's surprising all the people that start following you and listening to what you're writing, right? So that's one way of getting your expertise and experience out there. The other thing is Twitter. Twitter is about writing short, sentences or summaries on, articles that you found interesting or things that you found interesting. It's very easy to create a Twitter handle, like mine is @SAgarwal. You can go to twitter.com and you can start listening for, things that are important in your area or field of expertise. So, mm-hmm. for example, if you're in the medical space and you want to know something about biomedical, developments that have happened, right. There are hashtags in Twitter that help you just listen in to what other people are saying.
Well, great. These are some great resources. Okay, next, writing a resume. I read somewhere that unless your resume catches the interviewer's eye in 10 seconds, mm-hmm. it's over. You're not going to get that interview call. So what would you say is a well-written resume?
Mm-hmm. Well, first of all, you know, what is a resume? What is the purpose of a resume before we get to sort of what is a well-written resume? Just realize that a resume, you never get a job because of your resume.
Mm-hmm.
What the resume helps you do is open that door. Open that door to getting an interview, right? So it's very important because it's sort of a first impression that someone is getting off of you, but it's not how you end up getting the job.
Right.
Your resume needs to be a concise written summary of your work experience, your education, and your accomplishments. You need to think about what are the things that set you apart from the competition. There are probably other people that are in their resume talking about some things that they might also have done. But if you can talk about what you've done and the impact that it has made to the business, for example, how it has improved the top line, which means how you've helped with revenue creation, mm-hmm. or how it has improved the bottom line, which means how you've helped with creating profitability, or how you've helped in customer satisfaction, and using some concise examples to, you know, substantiate what you're saying in those resumes, that is what makes the resume very powerful. And as I've said before, make sure you use keywords in those resumes. Like if you think about someone's looking for you, right? How would they find you? What are the words in your background that they would find really interesting that they would search on? Because these days, most of your resumes are going to be online.
Right.
You'll send them out via email, or they'll be on your job sites, or they'll be on LinkedIn, etc. So put in some keywords out there.
Should the resume be like, you know, limited to a page or 2 pages, or you can give long resumes also?
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, most of the time people only have 30 seconds to look at a resume and make a decision if they want to continue that conversation. So a resume that is 2 or 3 pages long generally does not, you know, add any value, right? It's the first page, your last 2 or 3 jobs, and maybe your education that kind of stands out. So in general, my recommendation is to do 1-page resumes, mm-hmm. but at most 2-page resumes, because the rest of it, you'll communicate in your interview.
Oh, okay. So what about a cover letter? Should this accompany a resume?
Absolutely. You know, especially if you're doing sort of online, you know, you're responding to a job post on LinkedIn, right? You always want to write a cover letter. Remember, the cover letter is an introduction, and mm-hmm. While a resume is somewhat more structured, a cover letter gives the person a feel for why you're an accurate fit for that job or that position, gives them a little understanding of how you might be unique towards that particular opportunity, so you can say a little bit. But once again, you know, don't spend too much time on the cover letter. It's just an introduction. It's just a way to connect with someone.
Once you get that interview call you've been waiting for,
mm-hmm.
then what? I hear all the time that you have 60 seconds to impress the interviewer.
Mm-hmm.
So how should you prepare for an interview?
Well, I think there are a few things to really think about. You know, one is, you know, being prepared. The biggest mistake people can make is going into an interview without knowing everything they can about that opportunity, about that company, about the people that they will be speaking with. And today there's so much data out there that you can spend the time and do the research, learn about their products, learn about their services, learn about their executives, learn about, you know, how they're approaching the market, what is the market that they're going to. And not just that, think about what are the types of questions that come to your mind in terms of, you know, what would I like to know, right? I mean, you don't know that business as well as they do.
Mm-hmm.
So what are some things that you would like to know, such that just as they're judging you, you're judging them in terms of what is it that, you know, is this the right place for me or not? The other thing to think about is, you know, it's very basic, but get there ahead of time. There's nothing worse than being late to an interview. One, it definitely doesn't provide a good, you know, feeling to the interviewer. So they don't
Sure.
think it's important enough. They couldn't even show up here in time.
Sure.
But the other thing is about how you feel. You know,
mm-hmm.
running into a interview, being flustered, maybe sweating, you know, and just, you know, berating yourself for being late because you know you don't want to be late.
Sure.
You don't want to go through that process. And if that means, you know, you're going into unfamiliar territory and you have to make a dry run in the evening, if you really care about that job, do it.
Drive by, see the place.
How do you get there? You know, parking, etc. So just
sure.
basic things, but they cannot come in your way
mm-hmm.
of being there 10 minutes ahead of time. It's okay to sit in the lobby. It's okay to sit in your car, but don't be late. It's a very basic thing. And in terms of, you know, how you dress, I mean, you want to show that this is important to you, that you're a professional. So dress a cut above maybe what the attire might be in general at the organization.
Even in the Bay Area, where people are so casually dressed?
Absolutely. I mean, I, you know, we have a lot of interviews that happen at our organization. And I'll tell you, you know, sales reps who don't come dressed up, even though on a regular basis they might not be wearing a tie, you know, the thought is, well, didn't they care enough to, you know, dress up, even if it's Friday casually? Unless, obviously, the interviewer tells you, look, you don't need to dress up, you know, here's the dress code for this. It doesn't hurt to ask, right? You definitely don't want to be dressed inappropriately. Mm-hmm. So continuing down the path of, you know, what are things?
No,
great questions. You know, practicing and learning from each interview. I mean, interviewing is a skill, you know. You have to practice. And the best way to practice is to interview. And that's a chicken and egg problem, right? How do I practice without an interview? And then you have to practice in an interview. But, you know, do a lot of them. And then always think about, what have I learned from this experience? What could I do better the next time? What could I do different? And even, you know, what did I do well? What made the interviewer feel good about me? You know, what made me feel good in myself as I was talking? Those positive feelings will always come out. So don't just think about what could I do better, but also think about, what have I done well, right? And what can I replicate in the future? And then, you know, the last thing is, you've invested all this time in getting to that interview.
Right, that's a tough thing in any case.
Right, you know. And so now the thing is, what kind of an impression do you make after you've left that place? So make sure you follow up. You follow up with a really nice thank you note. Think about something that they said or you said that you guys connected on, and think about how you can use that in your email to personalize your email, and then reiterate your interest, reiterate your appropriateness for the job. Now, this thank you note can't be like 7 pages long. It's just a paragraph or two, but it's something that you have to walk away thinking, you know, what did I connect with that person on?
So it's for each interviewer that is on the panel.
Absolutely, that's a very good point. It's not a generic email that you send to A, B, C, D, and E. You CC everyone and you send an email saying thank you. You're actually sending individual emails. You know what happens with those emails? Is that people who've interviewed you forward those emails to the hiring manager.
Okay.
So now the hiring manager is seeing, you know, what is the connection that you've established in each of those interviews.
Okay, if the interviewer asks at the end of the interview, do you have any questions? What would be some intelligent questions to ask of the interviewer?
Sure, absolutely. You know, I've been saying all along that you should be thinking about the questions that you want to ask in terms of the business, in terms of the way they do things, in terms of the role. That has to be an ongoing process during the interview. It is not a monologue where, you know, they're asking questions, you're providing answers. Make it comfortable. Make it a dialogue to some extent. Obviously, give them the time that they can ask the questions that they want, because they're there to ask the questions. But at the same time, your ability to ask questions and the kinds of questions you ask are just as important in their mind in deciding whether this person can think on their feet, this person is asking intelligent questions, etc. But as you end the meeting or the interview, there are a couple key questions that you want to ask because you've invested a lot of time and effort in getting to this place, investing your energy, doing research, etc. So these are what I would call sort of closing questions, or getting a sense of where you stand. So one question could be, what are your thoughts on me being a good fit for this role? Now this is
a good question.
Thank you. This is a very open-ended question. Mm-hmm. It's not like they could just answer with a yes or a no, and that's the end of that discussion. You're saying, what are your thoughts on me being a good fit for this role? They've got to come up with something intelligent. And what is the intelligent thing that comes out? Generally, it's a frankness about what they really appreciated from you. Mm-hmm. And maybe even, if you're lucky, a little bit about what did not work, right? Or what could be areas of improvement. And the next thing is, what are the next steps and the timeline for hiring someone? So you're not saying, what are the next steps for hiring me? But you're making sure that you understand what they want to happen and what is the timeline within which is going to happen. Because then you know maybe there is something that you need to do, you know, in that interim, you know, to support their next steps.
Okay, and what are some questions you should not ask?
Well, I think it's how do you not come across as premature? And unless you've received an indication that they are willing to hire you, or you're one of the final two candidates or something, you don't want to ask questions around compensation. Because that is looked at as, you've probably gotten a sense of what the compensation is going to be based on their job post, et cetera. So you want to hold off on that until you're much closer to actually getting that offer.
Okay. Let's see. Should one have some kind of a body language to impress the interviewer that you're very interested and that you're very capable of doing that job?
I'm very interested in the questions you're asking me, right? And you look at my body language. I'm leaning forward. I'm looking into your eyes. I'm using my hand gestures, etc. So those are the kind of things that you want to do. So they understand that this is important to you, that you care about it, and that you're listening intently. You're not just thinking about what answers you're going to provide. Your excitement and your interest and your desire for this job will show on your face. It's very hard to mask the reaction that is within you, what you feel. So smile, relax, and answer questions with the knowledge and experience you know you have. You're not trying to make things up.
What are some of the trick questions the interviewers ask? And what would you say to, how should you answer them confidently?
Sure. You know, one of the things that we're all prepared to talk about is what our areas of strength are, how good we are, right, in certain areas, how well we do certain things. Excellent. Talk about those. Definitely provide examples of why I'm hardworking or why I'm the best neurosurgeon there is, or whatever the reason, whatever the area of questioning might be. But the thing that people don't think about as much or have a hard time is, what are my areas of improvement, which can be translated to, what are my weaknesses? Spend some time really thinking about it and being realistic with yourself, you know, before the interview, or before the set of interviews you're doing, is, what is it that I need to do better? I mean, Renu, I'm sure you're working on certain things to do better. I'm working on things I know constantly to improve upon, right? So sit down, ask your family, ask yourself, what is it that I could do better? Because what you're doing in your family life is probably also things that you can do better in your professional life and vice versa. Right? So ask yourself, what are your areas of improvement? Now, obviously, you don't want to go up there and say, oh, I don't do this well, and I don't do this well, and I don't do this well, right? That doesn't come across really well. So be upfront about, okay, here are my areas of improvement, but here's what I'm doing about it. And here's how I have changed over the last year, last 2 years, along these lines. And here's the impact it has made. Here's how it has removed the negative impact of what I'm working on as areas of improvement. That is a very mature way of responding to, what are my weaknesses, not just listing them off, but talking what you're doing about it, right, and how you've evolved over the last few years.
Okay. Now, going for an interview, one might be nervous. Any tips that would help someone be more comfortable?
You know, you have to be confident in your strengths and your capabilities. They want you, or they need you, as much as you need them. For an employer to hire the wrong person means a wasted 6 to 9 months, because they spend 3 to 6 months ramping you up. There's an opportunity cost of spending time on training you, on investing in you, and then also what you are supposed to accomplish during that time.
Right.
So they're being very careful about trying to figure out who the right person is, and that is why you're bringing value to them. So be confident in that. You know, what's the worst that can happen? The worst that can happen is you don't get this job. Well, we've talked enough that this is a law of large numbers. Don't take that personally. Move on to the next application. The worst that can happen, you don't get this job. They're not going to take your money away. They're not going to take your health away. They're not going to take your family away, right? That's not going to happen. So what is there to be afraid of?
Right. Okay, now I have a job offer, or I'm very lucky to get multiple offers. How should I proceed?
I think of my life in maybe a 40-year working lifespan, or time span. And my goal is, each job that I'm working at, I spend 4 to 5 years there, which means I only have maybe 8-10 decisions to make in my entire life. And I've used up over half of those decisions. I maybe only have 2 or 3 more left to go. So I better make those 2 or 3 count. So it's very important to think about, you know, where are you going to work? Don't just don't just pick the one that gives you the most pay. Don't think too much about, oh, my commute is this. But balance sort of, you know, the family life with your work life. And one of the exercises I've recommended to people is to say, here's job A and here's job B. And you think about in the middle first, listing for yourself, what are the 10 important things to me? It might be money, it might be career, it might be family, it might be time with friends, time with kids, whatever it is, what are the 10 things? Then look at the job on the left-hand side and say, how do I rate this job from 1 to 10? You put a number down, right, for each of these values that you have in your life. Now forget about this job, go over to the other side and do that same exercise for this other job. You know, 1 mm-hmm. to 10, how does, for example, this suffice my career goals, right? Maybe the job on the right is 8, whereas the job on the left is a 4, okay? But what you're doing is you're thinking objectively against your values. Now, when you're done with this exercise on the two jobs, go across each row. So for example, for career, which job won out? Maybe it's this job. So you circle this side. Mm-hmm. You know, what happens with the other values? Which jobs win out? Now, the job that has the more circles on it over these 10 or 15 values that you have, right, that is an objective decision making around which job is better for you. And doesn't just take one aspect of emotion or one aspect of thought in your process, right? So make it count and make the decision valuable for yourself and your family.
Okay, we are all out of time, Siddharth. Thank you for appearing on our show and giving so many valuable tips on how to land your job.
Sure, absolutely.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, I wish everyone the best of luck and hope this is useful in some way in helping people land that dream job.
I'm sure this is going to be very helpful.
Excellent. Thank you, Renu.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. We thank you for taking the time out to be with us today, and hope some of you may find this program helpful in your quest for a job. Do tune in next week for another episode of The Better Part. Until then, goodbye.